Welcome to the channel. In this video, I'm going to show you the steps of installing a Hunter Channing 52-inch indoor ceiling fan with lights on a flat ceiling. Even if you're not planning on installing the fan yourself, I have a quick tip for speeding up the install, which could help save you money, especially if you're planning to hire someone to install multiple fans. You'll need the following tools: a voltage detector or voltage tester, a Phillips screwdriver, or preferably a drill with a Phillips bit, an adjustable wrench, measuring tape, wire stripper, and a ladder. First, make sure you turn off power to the light box at the breaker panel and verify that you flipped the correct breaker by using a voltage detector. They all light up and make noise typically when voltage is present. Therefore, after flipping the breaker, make sure that the detector remains unlit and quiet when you place it near the wires from the light box. Here's a quick tip for speeding up the install process whether you or somebody else is going to be replacing the fan. Take the fan blades, fan blade arms, rubber grommets, and screws out of the box so you can assemble all of them ahead of time. This is the most time-consuming part of the whole process because it requires pushing the rubber grommets into the holes on the fan blades and then attaching the arms to the blades with the provided screws until tight. I also prefer to do this step first when installing fans in general, because if I'm short on time, I can knock this out in advance and proceed with the rest of the install later, and pretty quickly. One other pre-install tip is to remove the fan motor from the box and turn it upside down so that the side where the fan blades will connect is facing up towards you. Fan blade arm screws are often connected through a plastic spacer onto the body of the motor. Those screws can be removed ahead of time, as they'll be used later to connect the fan blades to the fan motor. Next, look for a mounting bracket. This will be screwed into the ceiling fan box with its rubber feet touching the ceiling. At this point, we could again double check that there is no power going to the wires that we're about to work with. Locate the down rod. Here, I'm installing one that came in the box without an extension, since the ceiling height in our particular room is about 9 feet. You'll want to double check your ceiling fan height ahead of time, as the suggested down rod length is based on ceiling height for adequate airflow. With the fan motor left in the box, feed the fan wires through the down rod. Locate the pre-installed set screw at the base of the motor and make sure that it's backed out enough so that you can tighten the down rod into the motor housing. Once you have it hand tight, make sure you tighten that threaded pin with an adjustable wrench. Using a tape measure, measure the ceiling fan wires 8 inches out from the top of the down rod or the length that's specified in your fan install guide, and then cut them with wire cutters. Cut wires can be discarded. Next, we can strip off 3/8 of an inch from the top of each wire with a wire stripper. Locate the canopy and place it over the down rod so that it's resting on the fan motor. Pick up the fan motor and place the hanger ball into the mounting bracket opening. Note the shape of this one and many others are typically triangular, so there are a few ways that the motor can be oriented. Think about which direction you want the brand name or the brand logo to be facing in that particular room. Do you want to see it when you enter that room or not? For connecting wires, make sure that black wires are connected together with the wire nut. Make sure the white wires are connected together with the wire nut. Make sure the green, or they might be green and yellow striped, wires plus your ground or copper wire are also all together connected with a wire nut. If you have a single switch, such as just one light switch that's going to operate both your ceiling fan light and your ceiling fan blades at the same time, you can simply put a wire nut over top of that blue wire that's coming out of the ceiling fan. If, however, you have a dual wall switch that's going to operate both your fan blades as well as your fan lights separately, we can go ahead and connect the red wire and the blue wire together with the wire nut. Take a look at your fan manual to make sure that your wire connections are correct. When aligning the tips of the wires, try to hold them still while tightening the wire nut. And when this has been done, don't just stop here. Continue holding the wires with one hand while tightening the wire nut with your other hand until you create a few tight loops with the connected wires. Go for at least 2 twists. That will help ensure that the wires under the wire nut are also twisted. Lightly pull on each of your connected wires and make sure all are secured within the wire nut and that none pull free. Twisting the wires to this extent may not be required per code, but it's shown on wire nut packaging and it's also for me a personal preference to ensure a good connection. With this method too, there's less risk of the wires coming free from the wire nut over time. With all wires connected, tuck the wires into the junction box or into the space between the ceiling fan box and the hanger ball. Raise the canopy up towards the mounting bracket and align the screw holes on both so that the screws can be used to connect those two pieces together. Locate the screws for your fan blades. These are often connected to the fan motor through plastic spacers, so if you remove them earlier and even assemble the fan blades earlier, you're ready to connect the fan blades to the motor. I like to place the first two opposite each other because it helps to balance out the motor, which then keeps the blades up out of your face while you work to connect the other remaining blades. Screw two of the three screws for the switch housing halfway in, not all the way in. Locate the upper switch housing and feed the wire plug through the center of the hole, lining up the keyhole slots over the screws, and then we're going to twist counterclockwise so that then we can screw tight those two screws that we partially installed earlier. There's also going to be a third screw that goes into place and we can tighten all three down. Connect the plugs from the upper and lower switch housings, lining up the colored markings on the connectors. Partially install two of the light kit screws and align the notches in the side of the lower switch housing with the screws in the upper switch housing. We can twist the lower switch housing clockwise to lock it into place. Once that's been done, we can tighten down all of the screws. To install the shades, first loosen the thumb screws or socket rings, if you have them, so the shade glass can be held flush and held into place by tightening all thumb screws or socket rings. With the thumb screws, I like to twist each about three times before I move on to tighten the others until the shade glass is secure. Tightening the screws equally means that the screws all protrude a similar amount. Install a bulb into each socket and you're nearly done. If you have pull chains for the fan and light to install, clip those into place. Flip the breaker back on and turn the wall switch on to make sure both the light and the fan works, whether that means we're checking to see that they work together because we have a single wall switch or that they work individually because we have a dual wall switch. If they do, you've connected all wires correctly. If either the light or the fan is not operational, take another look at the installation instructions and just double check your wire connections. Make sure all of them are tight as well within that wire nut. Flip back off your breaker at your panel box before you go back up there to start looking again at your wire connections. We replaced our single wall switch with a dual one that controls the fan and the light separately. This particular fan came with a wall-mounted remote, but we preferred the look of an integrated switch, so opted to not use the one provided. For those who are interested, the wall switch that we installed is a Lutron fan control and light dimmer, which is for dimmable LEDs, incandescent, and halogen bulbs. If you're interested in any of the products shown in this video, I'll provide links for each in the description. Thank you so much for watching, and if you found this video useful, please give it a thumbs up.